instruments, you know, they are your armamentarium. This is just like army uses their guns and all, you use these things. You should know each and everything about the instruments, what is the name of the instrument, who has given this instrument, to give full credit to the one who has discovered or invented the particular instrument. And then how to be used, how to be disassembled, how to assemble it back, what could be the possible indications and contraindications and the side effects and all, we are going to discuss about. So we start with something which is very commonly used, is this. This is a rigid laryngoscope. Chevalier Jackson was the one who at first given the concept of laryngoscopy. But you know, the father of laryngoscopy is Manuel Garcia, who was so enthusiastic. He was a speech protagonist. He was a musician himself. So he had got this curiosity to see inside the larynx how we speak and sing. So he used two mirrors in the sunlight and he saw his larynx on his own. He could see the vocal cords and subglottis, even the tracheal rings. So he was so surprised and he was elated to see that. Then he has given the concept of indirect laryngoscopy and laryngoscopy though. So we call him father of laryngoscopy, as laryngology. But father of laryngoscopy, bronchoscopy, esophagoscopy is Chevalier Jackson. Because he first used an instrument to see inside the throat, to see the esophagus, to see the bronchus, to see the trachea, to see the larynx. So this is a laryngoscope, rigid laryngoscope. This is not the Chevalier Jackson one. The Chevalier Jackson laryngoscope has got a handle around this. So you can use this handle like this. But this is clean saucer rigid laryngoscope. Why this is there? Why this slot is there? This slot is used to fix it to the suspension laryngoscope. Okay, so when you are doing microscopic laryngeal surgery, you use suspension to be inserted in this, and you insert it by using your non-dominant hand. So this is rigid laryngoscope, the clean saucer type. What are the other types we could have? We have got Negus type, we have got Jackson's type. The basic difference about Negus and Jackson's is, a Negus type is a proximal illumination type, and the Chevalier Jackson's type is a distal illumination type. Like in this laryngoscope, we use a light carrier which is inserted like this, and the tip comes over here. So this is our Jackson's type, distal illuminating type of laryngoscope. So what are the indications of laryngoscope we use? You know, so direct laryngoscopy is gold standard to examine the larynx. It is the gold standard examination. Not your indirect laryngoscopy, not your flexible, it is the gold standard. So why we have to do a direct laryngoscopy, why not indirect laryngoscopy itself? Because you know, the indirect laryngoscopy gives you an inverted image. It doesn't give you a real image, it is a mirror image. Okay, in indirect laryngoscopy, you will always see white vocal cords. That different colors inside the larynx you can't make out on indirect laryngoscopy. The vocal cord will always look like flat. The level of the vocal cord cannot be ascertained if there is a palsy. You can't ascertain that one vocal cord is at a lower level, although you can make out the length of the vocal cord. But this is something when you see a real picture through it. When you do it under general anesthesia, it should be done. So what are the indications of doing it over the indirect laryngoscopy is that, in indirect laryngoscopy, as at disadvantages I've told you, besides that, what there are certain areas which you can't see by the indirect laryngoscopy, like apices of piriform fossa, like anterior commissure, like ventricles, like the subglottis, like the petiole of epiglottis, that is laryngeal surface of epiglottis. Lower infrared part of laryngeal surface of epiglottis cannot be properly seen. So all these places are there which you can't see by the indirect laryngoscopy. Then you can't take a biopsy from indirect laryngoscopy. You can't map the disease in indirect laryngoscopy. Then you can do it with rigid laryngoscope. So that's why we are using this rigid laryngoscope. Now, so what is the position of rigid laryngoscope? The position we use is typical Boise's position. It is known as Boise's position, which is used for laryngoscopy, which is used for astrophotoscopy, and the same one is used for bronchoscopy. The concept is you have to align the esophagus or the larynx or the bronchus in a single line parallel to the upper incisors, so that you can right from or mouth opening you can see inside the airway or in the esophagus. That's what the concept of Boise's position, also known as barking dog position, also known as morning sniffing position, also known as sword swallowing position. So what do you do in Boise's position? You extend the neck at atlanto-axial joint and you flex it at the neck. So you extend it like this and you flex. So this becomes a straight line with your airway and the esophagus. This is something known as Boise's position. Okay, it should be done under general anesthesia. Okay, your non-dominant hand is used once. You, after giving the position, making the position, you retract the lips, you retract the lower jaw a bit from your, with your right hand, and then you insert it over the tongue, then you go up to the uvula, you go just below the uvula, you see the posterior ventral wall, you insert inside, keeping the soft tissue apart so that you don't injure the lips or the cheek mucosa or the teeth. So don't give additional pressure on the teeth. You make a fulcrum of the lower jaw, not the upper jaw. Once you make the fulcrum at the upper jaw, when you are inserting it, you can injure the upper teeth, upper jaw teeth, incisors and the canines. So you insert it and lift the lower jaw a bit. See the posterior ventral wall, go there, see the AE folds, area epiglottic folds. Then you push it some more and you will see the vocal cords. If it is not possible to see the AE fold, then you go along the tongue base, you see the valicula, you see the epiglottis. At first, you lower it down, lift the epiglottis and go in the glottis. So this is how both ways you can do. Because in short, thick neck or anteriorly placed larynx, sometimes it is very difficult to go from the posterior to anterior and you can't reach there. So this is how you can do it. One more thing, if it is a difficult patient, a obese patient, short neck, what you could do is you can lower the head of the patient below the table. Shorten down your stool, operating stool, take the head below the edge of the table, say somebody to just sit on the floor and hold the head. Then you can insert it properly. So it becomes in the alignment. Okay? So after doing it, if you are doing a microscopic laryngeal surgery, then you can fix it with the suspension. Okay, and suspension can be placed with a ring, a rubber ring it has got, over the, a sheet on the chest, or you, to avoid injury and compression on the chest, you can use a Mayo's trolley. We all know Mayo's trolleys are used in OT itself, which can be lowered down, which can be heightened up over the OT table, or even in the ward setting, you can use it for some nutrition to the patient or keeping medicines over it. So a Mayo's trolley can be used, and over that you can fix the suspension laryngoscope. Okay, so after you fixed, then you can manipulate inside. But if you are just doing DL, you can use this non-dominant hand to hold it, and you can use your instruments inserting in and doing this. Okay, so this is all about direct laryngoscopy. The complications can have injury to soft tissue, the tongue, the teeth, you can injure the posterior ventral wall, you can injure the e-folds, wherever you are exerting extra pressure, you can do that. Okay, so don't just touch the vocal cords with it. If you want to see the subglottis, you can just rotate it at 90 degree, use the bevel end to be inserted along one of the vocal cord and just move it on both sides, you can see the subglottis there. Okay, this is how you can do. So, what are the indications? Diagnostic as well as therapeutic indications. Diagnostic, like mapping the disease. If you are dealing with a cancer, you can map the disease. What is mapping the disease? Is staging the disease. So you can stage the disease, whether it is involved in the pancreatic space, ventricle, going to invade in the cricoid, or the subglottis or something like that. So this is how you stage the disease along with the direct laryngoscopy findings and the imaging findings on CT or MR. Okay, so this is something stains the disease. You can diagnose what pathology is there, whether it is a mobile nodule or a polyp or keratosis, or it is a cleft of the larynx, or it is something there in the subglottis, varicose lesion, malignancy. All these things you can make out through the this thing. So this is a diagnostic thing. In therapeutic, you can take a biopsy, you can remove the polyp or any benign tumor of the larynx. Even the malignancies you can remove if you do have laser along, or maybe with the help of the coblator. You can use it in juvenile laryngeal chlamydosis. So you can use it to remove the foreign bodies, that is therapeutic. Okay, you can use it to do an abscess drainage from the larynx itself. You can use it along with the thyroplasties you do, like mutilation thyroplasties, or maybe you are doing it with microsurgical techniques or microflap techniques in cases of vocal polyps or nodules, you can use it there. Or even if in injection thyroplasties, you can use this and you can make an incision there in the paraglottic space or at the junction of the vocal cord to the paraglottic space. So this is how you can use this direct laryngoscope. I think this is all about direct laryngoscopy. We can switch over to the next instrument, which is a rigid esophagoscope. So when you talk about rigid esophagoscope, you should talk about bronchoscope as well. Okay, in rigid esophagoscope, you will see that like the bronchoscope, it does not have any vent. Why vents are not there? Because esophagoscope, it does not require ventilation there in the esophagus. While the bronchoscope requires these vents, because when you are going in the one bronchi, the other bronchus should also get ventilation, and that is possible through these vents. Okay, these channels, air channels. So if you talk about rigid esophagoscopy, again the position voices we have already talked about, and the length, adult bronchoscope, the length should be 40 centimeters. In pediatric bronchoscope, it is usually 25 centimeters. Why it is 40 centimeters? Because your esophagus is 25 centimeters, and to reach to the esophagus from the upper incisors is 15 centimeters added to that. So when you insert it, you are having a blind tube. You don't have any anatomical landmark there except the A fold behind that you insert it. So that's why you do have these markings in centimeters to know how much deep I have inserted my esophagoscope. So there are a few constrictions, like at 15 centimeters you will encounter the cricopharyngeal sphincter. At 25 centimeters, you will have an impression of the arch of the aorta. 27, it is the carina, it is the angle of Louis, somewhere around T5. At C6, pneumopharynx. T4, it is crossing the aorta, arch of the aorta. T5, it is 27 centimeters, the left main bronchus, angle of Louis place there. Then you go to 40 centimeters, that is your lower esophageal sphincter, at somewhere around T9 or T10 it reaches. So how to use it? The same thing, at first you will hold it like a pen in the non-dominant hand. You can elevate the lower jaw with a laryngoscope, make Macintosh laryngoscope of the anesthetist, or you can just insert it lowering the jaw with your hands. Avoid soft tissue injury, just put it there, see the uvula, go to the posterior ventral wall, go along the posterior ventral wall. When you feel there is a nerve, there is a space, just elevate it up, you will see AE fold, you are sure you are behind the AE fold, that means you are going to insert in the upper esophageal sphincter. You insert it, if you feel some resistance, you could say anesthetist to please relax the patient some more. You can say anesthetist to deflate the cuff of the endotracheal tube, because the bulb can be pushing the posterior wall of trachea, which is deficit of tracheal rings, over the esophagus to flatten the esophagus. That's why you may be having some resistance down there. So you can see that, say that. Or what you could do use? You could use a 10% or a 4% jalogaine to desensitize that area so that the spasm is relieved. Then slowly you insert this in the upper esophageal sphincter, that is a cricopharyngeal sphincter. Most of the foreign bodies are lost at the cricopharyngeal sphincter. So you have to be very gentle there. As soon as anesthesia is given, you insert it, the foreign body can go below that. So you go along with that, the bevel end should be kept anteriorly. Okay? The bevel end should be anteriorly. And you insert it slowly, slowly. Keep your right hand free so that you can use a forceps to remove the foreign body, or diagnostic procedures like you can take a biopsy, or you can suction out the certain things. Okay, so keep your right hand free. When you insert it inside, see the markings, take out the foreign body if you are doing diagnostic. If you encounter some narrowing, don't push it hard. Try to go slow. If it is not possible, use the elastic boozies to dilate the things and then go along. Okay? You start with the narrowest possible boozy and you increase the size of the boozy to dilate the esophagus. Then you can insert it up to the lower esophageal sphincter. Even you can insert it inside the stomach and you see the regions of stomach. You can make out where leads to the stomach. So this is how the esophagoscopy should be done. No foam pressure to be given anywhere. The most common complication you can encounter is soft tissue injuries, but the dreaded complication is esophageal perforation, which is most common there at the tip of the sphincter. When will you know this esophagus has been ruptured? So, when you have got a giveaway pain, when you see blood inside, when at first the tachycardia is there and hypotension is there, and if you listen to the heart or chest, there would be muffled cardiac sounds there. Patient might feel later on interscapular pain due to the esophageal puncture. There would be crepitations there in the neck, maybe the surgical emphysema. In that condition, suction out, immediately put in a rise tube under observation, keep the patient NBM. Blood should be instituted, broad spectrum antibiotics should be done, and try to keep the patient in ICU and observe. Okay, 48 to 72 hours NBM should be done, nothing by mouth to the patient. How do you avoid injuring the esophagus when you are taking the biopsy or doing the procedure? You should use the side of the biopsy forceps. Don't ever insert the biopsy forceps in the wall. Use the side of the biopsy forceps prongs to take a biopsy. Okay, so that you don't go through and through. So this is how the esophagoscopy is done. Same complications, indications, same diagnostic as well as therapeutic indications we have already talked about. You can ligate the varices, you can cauterize the varices, you can put in a stent in the esophagus through this. So there are a lot of indications that you can go ahead with. So third thing will come. And the second thing is, this is wider, so it can't be a pediatric esophagoscope. Then what is this? This is a hypopharyngoscope. This is not an esophagoscope. This is a hypopharyngoscope, which is inserted up to the hypopharyngoscope only, and you can make out it is only 16 to 17 centimeter. Okay, so to take a biopsy from the hypopharyngoscope or to take out the foreign body from there, because a pediatric esophagoscope would be a thinner one. It won't be having any channels like in the bronchoscope. That is the difference there. Next, we come to the bronchoscope. What other esophagoscopy techniques are there is flexible esophagoscopy technique, which could be done for oral or maybe for nasal, and you can go inside, you can take a biopsy, you can see the whole GI tract up to the duodenum. Okay? Sorry. So, this is rigid bronchoscope, and we have already talked about. This has also been discovered by Chevalier Jackson. Most of the contribution to the endoscopies of the neck, throat, larynx, airway has been given by Chevalier Jackson. The position is same, voice is, the anesthesia is same, but the ventilation is changed in this technique. What are the different types of ventilation you can use in bronchoscope? Why don't we have markings over bronchoscope? Because in bronchoscopy, when we insert it, we see the anatomical landmarks like tongue, then epiglottis, elevate the epiglottis, we see the vocal cords, then we see the rings of the trachea, then we see a keel, that is your keel carina, that is an inverted keel shaped structure we see, and then we insert it in the stratum, wider, shorter right main bronchus, which is there at an angle of 25 to 30 degree, as compared to the left main bronchus, which is at an angle of 75 degrees, which is longer, narrower, and more of on an angle. Okay, that's why most of the foreign bodies are in the right main bronchus. So this is how you go there and you see all the anatomical landmarks. That's why we don't have markings there. So ventilations could be like, it could be an apneic ventilator oxygenation. The anesthetist can give 100% oxygenation, then he can remove the ventilation, insert the things, remove the foreign body, or see a diagnostic procedure you are doing, repetitive procedure, come out, anesthetist will do the ventilation with a mask and bag again. This is something known as apneic oxygenation. Then comes a spontaneous assisted ventilation, in which you use the ventilating tube or their bag mask channel on the side of the bronchoscope like this. They insert it and it is spontaneous ventilation going on altogether. Then people were not happy with the spontaneous ventilation. Why? Because this spontaneous ventilation does not have that much pressure which is required to reach up to the alveoli, which is required to open the smaller airways so that our bronchoscope can be inserted, which is required to give you a forceps space to insert the prongs of the forceps around the foreign body. So that's why a jet ventilation concept came. So what is a jet ventilation? A jet ventilation is also known as Saunders ventilation technique. In jet ventilation, we use the principle of Venturi. What is the principle of Venturi? The principle of Venturi is basically based on the Bernoulli's principle. The Bernoulli's principle is based on the velocity and the constrictions. So whenever a high pressure is being exerted through a narrow channel, the pressure lowers down. Okay? See, this is what happens. When the pressure lowers down because of this high pressure, any air or fluid or whatever is surrounding to that tube will get entrapped. That is known as entrapment or entrainment. In simple language, it gets dragged in or sucked in. So whenever you are using a venturi during bronchoscopy, the venturi has got a needle, okay, a needle which is very narrow path, and you have got a manipulating manual ventilation, venturi ventilation. There are automatic venturi ventilation also, in which machine pushes air. In manual ventilation, when you are pushing it from 10 to 16 times per minute, you are giving it at a pressure of maybe 50 pascals, PSIs you are giving pressure. So when you are doing this manual pressure to the venturi, the pressure is being lowered down through the venturi needle, and what happens, there would be a negative pressure around this. This negative pressure will suck in because we will keeping this proximal opening of bronchoscope open. So the air would be sucked in. So this added air would be going along with the pure oxygen which is coming. So that is an advantage for the lowermost bronchi to open and the alveolus to open. And an added advantage that this high pressure is not going up to the alveoli to cause alveolar rupture, to cause injury to the respiratory membrane, to cause pneumothorax. So all these things can be avoided by using an open circuit venturi along with that. So this is how you are using that. The position we have talked about, you have to hold it like pen, you hold it in left hand like a pen, you use a laryngoscope, blade. Macintosh laryngoscope is used, which has got a curved blade. This, the tip of the blade should be inserted at the median glossal epiglottic fold in the valicula. When you elevated, the epiglottis will, when you press median glossal epiglottic fold, the epiglottis will come a bit anterior. You will see the epiglottis inserted behind that, and once you are like this, when you reach to the glottis, you give a 90 degree angulation to it, so that a bevel end should go along the vocal cord inside. When you are inside, you can do it like this, okay, so that these channels will come on the side of the bronchi. You see the tracheal rings, insert it, go to the keel. At first, go to the non-diseased sized sided bronchus, bronchus, see to it, come out. So when you are going in the right one, you need to a bit move the head towards left, because right one is comparatively straighter. When you want to see the left bronchus, you move the head along with this assembly towards left, so that it comes in the line up at the 675 degree angle of the left main bronchus. So this is how you see both the bronchus with it, okay? And eventually is going on through this, and you can use a Fluvox adapter, that is a plate which has got magnification lens, which has got a plain lens, and which has got a channel for instrumentation. So you can use a Fluvox adapter along with that, but I don't prefer to use, always use a closed Fluvox adapter there on this, because a closed one will build a lot of pressure due to venturi, will cause injury to the bronchi and alveoli, can cause pneumothorax or rupture of the things. Or maybe patient might have already have emphysema or emphysematous bully which can rupture. So use, keep it open. Meanwhile, you can open it, close it to see with the magnification lens, and you can use the channel to take out the foreign body. Once you are taking out the foreign body, don't say anesthetics to stop the ventilation. Rather, this ventilation is causing the bronchi to dilate a bit. When bronchus are getting dilated, you will have a space around the foreign body that is known as forceps space, so that your prongs of the bronchoscope can be inserted and you can hold the foreign body, and then you can stabilize the whole assembly. You hold the bronchoscope like this, you hold the forceps like this, you hold the forceps at one of the margin of the lumen with this, and make an assembly, then take it out a bit, and then take it out after the vocal cords. You rotate it, make it a 90 degree, come out, so that it does not entangle to any soft tissue structure, don't injure it, and you don't drop the foreign body there in the oropharynx or the hypopharynx, or it can slip to nasopharynx. So this is how the bronchoscopy is done. So these are all the principles of gent ventilation. We have already discussed about that. And the complications, you know, it is injury to the soft tissue, teeth, injury to the bronchus, vocal cords, and pneumothorax, surgical emphysema, all these things. Okay? So this is all, I think, about the bronchoscopy.